opportunities to share what they do in our space. So what we're going to introduce next is with the Health Servicing Agency. It's a nonprofit here in downtown. I'm going to go ahead and have our member Peter come up and introduce him. Peter has been with us as a loyal and faithful member of the Clubhouse community. He is going to share with you a little bit about what his organization does, and then we'll get on to the next speaker. So thank you, Peter.
Absolutely, a pleasure. Peter Buckley, and what I have is a little business complaint. It's an avocation called CSR Angels. We are an angel investor group. We're a part of a much larger group that's based in Greenville, and we speak for approximately 300 individual investors who come together to invest in things that excite their interest. It's very proficient, it's very professionally run, thanks to you guys in Greenville, not to me. All I do is I try to scare up some business and scare up some investors, and the rest is done by the pros in Greenville. We look for companies that are scalable, capital efficient. So you can think real estate, probably not. Tech, probably yes. That sort of thing. Sorry about that.
Sorry, Josh.
No, I'll be happy to talk to you about that. Our real estate is very scalable.
All real estate is scalable. I know that. No, we do actually break our own rules. So if you have something, we'll talk about it
later.
Great. Because I am looking for something local. We've been doing this for a couple of years now. There are 13 different groups, three of them in North Carolina, the rest in South Carolina. And everybody's responsible in theory for bringing companies to the central hub in Greenville. And I haven't found a company that works just yet. We've got a couple of people who are close, and hopefully, if I can mention names, George Sue,
okay,
who has Cafe, is probably going to be our first bona fide participant. We'll see.
Right, cool.
We'll see. But enough about me. Let me tell you a little bit about Ron, and it's going to be very little because Ron told him almost nothing about me. I did have to go to his LinkedIn. I found out that he is a proud Tennessee volunteer.
Go Vols.
He came here about 20 plus years ago and worked for EasyGo for most of those years before he found something which what you will soon be able to gather is something that really gets him going in the morning, keeps him going through the day, and he probably keeps him up at night. Ron is the Director of Communications and Development for Christ Communities Health Services, which is currently got two shops, one that way about 4 blocks and one this way about 4 blocks, yes, since this is supposed to be the epicenter. So you should all be, if you have healthcare needs, you should all be knowing about what he does, and it's going to be easy to get to. So what his job is, because of his double, he's got to get the word out and bring the money in. And so he's going to help us, and we're going to help him with whatever we can provide. And he will provide you with great health services and a wonderful description of what he wants. So thank you.
Yes, thank you. As Peter was sharing, I'm Ron Skeens. I am the Director of Development and Communications at Christ Community, which in plain English means PR and fundraising. So, Christ Community Health, you're entrepreneurs. Christ Community Health was started a little over 10 years ago by a medical entrepreneur. Dr. Robert Campbell left a thriving private practice in the golden land of Columbia County, moved down here to downtown Augusta with three other people to start a medical clinic for those in our community who do not have health insurance. It was two doctors, one nurse, and one person answering the phone in November of 2007. So, medical entrepreneur who came down here to break new ground and chart new territory in terms of providing quality, affordable health care to the underserved. When you go to the doctor, you walk up to the window, what do they ask for? Your driver's license and your insurance card. What happens if you don't have one of these? Well, with all the medical resources that we have in this community, there are still thousands and thousands of families and folks who don't have insurance. So what are the options? You can, if a private practice will take you, you can pay full price. Prompt care, health department, emergency room, all have their place. All do excellent work and have their place. Or what we find with a lot of our patients who don't have insurance is they do nothing. Something that can be managed, taken care of, becomes a crisis. always like to start with our mission. Our mission is to proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and demonstrate his love by providing affordable, quality health care to the underserved. Those are nice sounding words, but how does that play out? We were established in 2007, so we're a little bit older than the startups that I'm talking to here today. I realize that. We're a 501c3 nonprofit organization. We have our own board. We have our own bylaws, our own practices. We have two locations now, one at the end of Telfair Street, one over on Dantnack Street, right across from University Hospital. From those original four people, we have grown to more than 80 paid staff members now. We have 15 paid providers, doctors, dentists, PAs, nurse practitioners, and since we started, we've done 150,000 patient visits in those 10 years. And the way we work, our uninsured patients, what they pay is based on their income. It's a sliding fee scale. So that's how we charge someone who does not have an income. And I always like to point out that our folks who don't have insurance, there's a perception in the community that uninsured equates to unemployed and living on the streets. Most of our uninsured patients have a job or two jobs. They've got families. They're just trying to provide for their family, and that's why we're here to provide the medical and dental care that they need. Charts. Just throw this up to show you how we've grown. 2008, about 3,800 patient visits. So this is what happened from 2008 in terms of patient visits up to last year. With all the medical resources in this community, you would say, why do you need a Christ community? I think this kind of reflects the need within our community. 27,000 patient visits last year. And this is how those broke down. 6,700 individual patients. Almost 1,200 of those were 18 or younger. 10 counties around the Augusta area. 45% were uninsured. 38% Medicare and Medicaid, which in the lingo of the medical world is underinsured. A lot of practices don't take Medicare and Medicaid. So that's just a snapshot of last year. Internal medicine, family dentistry, pediatrics, women's health, and a long list of ancillary services that we provide. Those are the services that are available at Christ Community. We do have two locations. I want to recognize our executive director, Jeff Drake, here. He's our CEO. His office and mine are in this building right here. That's our original clinic on Dantnack Street. Our other clinic is in a building called the Widow's Home. This is at the far end of Telfair Street, 100 block that direction, or I guess that direction, whatever direction. I'm directionally challenged. What's neat about this building is that this land is the birthplace of both University Hospital and the Medical College of Georgia. University is doing their big 200th anniversary. Their original building was on this land, as was the original Medical College of Georgia. This building was built in 1887 for widows of the Civil War, hence the name Widow's Home. When two capital campaigns, we raised $3.5 million to turn the first floor into a full-service medical center with 12 exam rooms. The second floor has a physical therapy center. Third floor has an 8-chair dental clinic. So that is a quick snapshot of what we're doing with Christ Community. So why would any of you want to be involved or get involved with Christ Community? We can be a medical dental resource for startups in this room. If you need medical care or dental care, now I have to qualify that a little bit on the medical side. We have got an enormous demand for our medical services, more than we can meet at this time. So it's very difficult to get a medical appointment. On the other side of the coin, for pediatrics and for dental, we do have room on our schedule. So if you have children who need a pediatrician, if you need dental care, we opened our dental clinic a year ago in January, and it took off like a rocket. We exceeded our expectations. So we can potentially be a resource for those of you in this room. We're helping provide affordable quality dental care to thousands of families across this community. We're keeping people out of the emergency rooms. And if you want to get involved and help us, our focus this year is expanding our pediatric care. The demand for pediatric behavioral health services is growing beyond what we can keep up with. So we're bringing in a new pediatrician this summer. We're expanding our Laney Walker facility to add an exam room there to expand our pediatric care. So that's an opportunity for some of you to get involved with us two ways, in terms of us possibly being able to provide you with some care or to help us expand our pediatrics and our services we're providing to the community. So that is a very quick snapshot of Christ Community Health. If you want to tour an amazingly beautiful old building, come down to the Widow's Home and I'll show Jeff and I can show you what's going on down there, how we've renovated and restored that historic building. Thank you. I know this is a little bit of a different pitch than what you're used to hearing at a million cups, but I appreciate the time to share with you what we're doing. Are there any questions? Yes.
How many ghosts are in that Widow's Home?
We found three, two skeletons. No, didn't get to run into the ghost yet.
Another real question I have for you is, every year when you're filing your taxes, you need to submit something that says, I have insurance, I was insured all 12 months. Yes. Is there something, I don't know if this is the right question or not, but is there something that I can just sign up a one-year subscription with you guys and get that certification to say, yes, I'm insured, this is my provider, this is where I go?
We're not an insurance carrier. We're just providing the services to folks who don't happen to have insurance. So the short answer to your question is no, because we're not an insurance carrier.
Okay.
We take insurance, we take the Medicare, Medicaid, but we can't do that one for
you. Gotcha, okay. Just curious.
Sure. Yes?
For the pediatric behavioral expansion, what are your needs to meet that expansion goal?
Right now, we have a pediatric nurse practitioner who is also a pediatric mental health specialist. And the number of patients that she's seeing that fall into that second category needing pediatric mental health specialty care is growing. So we're bringing in another full-time pediatrician this summer who will focus entirely on the medical side of pediatrics, which will free up our mental health specialists to see more of the children who need that kind of attention with ADD and ADHD. So that's the strategic plan for bringing in this full-time pediatrician to free up some of the other high-risk practitioners' time to focus on pediatric mental health. Yes, sir.
Is this organization 100% self-sufficient? Are you guys subsidized by any way to stay afloat?
Here's our revenue pie. We're not a free clinic. As I said, everyone pays something based on their income. And so with Medicare and Medicaid, some of our patients have private insurance. And what's neat to me is when I talk to patients, I've run into a number of patients who, when they started coming to see us 8 years ago, had no job, no insurance, no nothing. Now they've gotten a job, they've gotten insurance, and they stay with us. And I ask them why, and they'll say, I'm getting the best medical care I've ever gotten, why would I go somewhere else? So about 40% of our revenue is what they pay on the sliding fee scale are insurance reimbursements. So the other 60% breaks down like this. We are what's called a federally qualified health center. The acronyms in the medical world are crazy. We're FQHC. We get a grant from the feds every year because we're in what's called an underserved area. With all the resources we've got, believe it or not, parts of Augusta are designated as medically underserved. So we get a grant from the feds for serving in an underserved area. University Hospital supports us financially because we're keeping people out of their ER. And then we're a United Way agency, and the rest of the funding, which is where my role sort of comes in, is donations from individuals all across the community, churches, organizations, special events. There's a list of our special events back there on the table if you'd like to look at them. Commercial break there. And so donations, grants, I do all of our grant writing, so that's how we get our financial pie put together. And we have finished in the black. You know, nonprofit doesn't mean unprofitable. So we have managed to finish every year in the black since we started in 2007. So that's how we stay afloat and how the finances are all put together.
Can I follow up real quick? It seems like I read about some doctors that decide to go out and go on their own and basically, you know, pay for your service up front.
Yes, concierge.
And they ran into resistance. from the medical association, that sort of thing, whether that is state government or federal. Mm-hmm. Did you run into any resistance when this business model was being put together?
No, because most private practices, they take insured patients. If you don't have insurance, you have a very tough time getting access to the care. So they are not, there was no resistance, no pushback at all, because there was a huge, when we first started, way more than half of our patients were uninsured. And for the typical private practice, their business model is not set up to deal with uninsured patients. That most will take some, you know, they'll set aside a portion of their patient schedule to see some uninsured patients, but we got no pushback at all, because the bulk of the patient base that we have is folks who really had no options, no action, no access to go other places. It was affordable.
That's a good question.
Other questions?
I'm with Doterra Essential Oils. Mm-hmm. So part of the reason that I went into the oils is that same thing with being underinsured and seeing that as a thing, as a big problem with our healthcare system. There are two things I've got a question on. One, what do you do, or are you do any kind of education as far for, you know, to keep them healthy? Mm-hmm. And two, what do you do, look at any integrative health as far as the whole system, or is it really more the traditional medical model of we'll see you when you're sick?
Okay, first question, yes, we do. We have someone on staff who is a patient educator. She sits down with patients one-on-one, explains, okay, this is your diagnosis, this is what you can do with diet and with other things to help control diabetes, cholesterol, that sort of thing. So yes, all of our providers work with our patients that way, but we have someone on staff who's a patient educator who sits down with the patients to address those kinds of needs. Give me a little more about your second question.
Integrated healthcare, one of the things that Doterra is working on is integrating the traditional model, mm-hmm. but also essential oils, yoga and that type of thing, that is a holistic mm-hmm. model, as opposed to treating the symptoms mm-hmm. and treating a disease, to also right. treat prior to and then also provide a whole systems basis.
We fall more to the traditional end of the scale on that. We're trying to treat the whole person in terms of the physical, the emotional, the spiritual, but we fall more on the end of the traditional treatment model in terms of what you're talking about. Yes?
So you mentioned that you aren't able to take more medical patients. What are you doing to try to do that?
We are actively recruiting more staff to expand our capacity. Two of our physicians left us last year. One took his family to Africa to do missions, and one went to work in the pediatric ER at university. So how are you going to argue with either of those? So we are actively recruiting more physicians to expand our capacity. So we're working on that.
So do you partner with using residents at all? Or?
Yes, we have. Right now we have medical internal medicine residents doing their three-year rotation with us. We have first year, second years, third years. We have dental hygiene students, we have physical therapy students, we have nursing students, so we've got great connections with AU and the medical center over there to get students involved in what we're doing, hoping that what they will realize is that there's a huge need in, and the word underserved is not my favorite word, but there is an underserved community, not just in Augusta, rural communities, urban communities across this country, and what we're hoping is that some of these students will catch that vision, like Dr. Campbell did when he came down to Augusta, into downtown Augusta to start Cross Community, and go do this somewhere else. Copy us. You know, we love to send people out. One of our founding physicians left Augusta, went to Columbus, started another clinic from scratch there. So yes, we're very involved with students and helping them understand the not everything is not just insured patients with, you know, these great private practices, their medical needs beyond that. So we're trying to help these students understand that. Yes, you have. Okay.
Do you have any other questions?
I will be around. Come for a tour. Call, go on our website, be around and ask any questions. Yes, we have one.
I work at Georgia Bulletin.
Yes.
I have referred many students to UDIs
over
the last couple of years. But I do have one question specifically about adult psychiatric care. That's probably one of the hardest things to be able to refer. Is that something you guys handle? Or do you know of the resources in the community that I can have to refer students?
We do it as best we can with our providers. We do not have anybody on staff to handle adult psychiatric. And Serenity, thank you. Serenity is who we don't have an official partnership with, but that's another. I mean, we'd love to add a lot more services than we've got, but that's one that right now we just don't have the resources to provide.
Can I add to that?
Yes.
There's another company called American Work, and they're on Riceboro Road. American Work.
Okay.
So they do adult psychiatric care also. And then we are...
Along those lines, they're like you guys?
Yes, I believe they do. Okay. But we are also looking at integrating behavioral health into our practice so that our primary care is better. So we are this summer going to pilot a program where we actually embed a licensed social worker to help with some of the smaller things so they don't grow into bigger things, and also helps to create better health in their primary care. So a lot of times some of the psychological issues are causing the health issues. So we're looking at piloting that and see how that goes, and we'll possibly expand that.
Thank you very much for your time.